Good morning. Oh, come on, you can't do better than that. Maybe I try German, guten Morgen. All right. I don't know Estonian, so I apologize. Thank you for having me. Thank you for that introduction, Lewis. Great to be here. It's a little nippy, but you know, in Detroit, where I'm from, it's also quite cold. I look forward to talking about LM Industries, which is actually the parent company of Local Motors. But let me just dive right in and say, what's the problem? And this is odd, right? I'm supposed to talk about mobility, but how many of you remember this? All right, remember when you dialed 9, it took forever? It was slow. But what happened about 10 years ago? 10 years ago, Apple revolutionized mobility for the telecom industry, right? How many of you still have a flip phone? Don't be shy. There's one of you in here. Nobody? Everybody has smartphones, right? So we have supercomputers in our pocket that give us access to anything in the world that we want to know about, right? We can Google, we can WhatsApp. Remember when you were in college? When I was in college, it cost a ton to call Europe. Now you just use WhatsApp and it's free. So all of these things you think about, but what brought that together? It was a convergence of technologies. Yet that convergence of technologies hasn't really revolutionized the way we think about cars. So when Gottlieb Daimler and Karl-Heinz Benz, two of my countrymen from Germany, I know you really think I was the German guy in here. The blonde hair and the blue eyes give it away every time. But when they created the vehicle back in 1886, and then Henry Ford added the assembly line in the early 1900s, that revolutionized mobility at the time, right? At first, it was called the horseless carriage. But what has happened in the 100 years since then? We're still making vehicles the same way, pretty much. Now, Tesla has come in and kind of revolutionized an electric vehicle, but they still make it in the same kind of plant that a Chevy Suburban is made, or a Ford F-150. It's a big plant, stamping sheet metal, assembly line, billions of dollars of investment, years of development, and then it spits out a vehicle. But why are we still doing that? Why, at the age of the internet, where we have this convergence of artificial intelligence, robotics, why are we still doing the things the same way? So what would Henry Ford have done 100 years ago if he had the digital age? That's what we asked ourselves. So is more the answer? Do we think more factories that have huge sustainability issues, huge investment issues, more congestion, is the future of mobility for us here in Estonia or in Detroit or Stuttgart or Tokyo? We don't think so. We think new mobility is the market. And when you think about the transaction cost of a vehicle, it's about $20,000. There's 100 million, or roughly 100 million, new vehicles produced a year. That means it's a $2 trillion or so market. But if you start thinking about, like, our good friends at Morgan Stanley, Adam Jonas, who talks about passenger miles traveled per year of $1 per mile of a value, and you get 10 trillion miles traveled, you have a $10 trillion market. That's about 5 times of what the current market is worth if you rethink mobility. And that in the U.S. alone represents $3 trillion of opportunity. So that's how we're thinking about the new mobility market, mobility as a service versus the traditional transactional cost of purchasing a vehicle. So what is the current race that we're all on? Right, this race to autonomy. And when you think about it, the current model is we own our own individual vehicles. How many of you drove here today? I know in Europe that's a different story than in America. Good, lots of public transit. The good part, this part where the joke doesn't work, because normally it's 80% of the people that raise their hands, and then I say, what are your vehicles doing right now? And they're doing nothing. But your vehicles may not even exist because you use public transit. But if you have a vehicle, what is it doing right now? Nothing. And normally, if you drive your vehicle, how many people are in it? Maybe one or sometimes two. So a vehicle made for five people has 20% utilization, occupancy rate, and it may be only used 3 to 5% of the time of the day. So that means 1% efficiency. That's today's model, and it's very expensive. It costs about $50 a day for a family to own two vehicles. That's a lot of money. Now people are starting to talk about the shared economy, right? Uber, Lyft, Taxify here in Estonia. And in the future, Tesla's thinking about owned autonomy, right? Autopilot, your own luxury vehicle that can take you from, you know, Detroit to Chicago while you sleep overnight. And then we think the future, however, is shared autonomy, right? That true transportation mobility as a service. And our perspective in the early midterm is that we're going to have fleets that are really smaller pods, under 25 miles an hour. That's going to usher in the area of autonomy. Not necessarily the highway speed or the transportation and logistics things that, for example, Starship Enterprises is working on. And then what it really comes down to is not just redefining the or actually having the autonomy in the vehicle. It's really about redefining the ride and the experience. And I'll get to redefining the ride a little later. But the experience is about, if you take those 10 trillion miles and do a little bit of math, you have around 600 billion hours of time that people spend in vehicles. And if you have that much time, that's worth a lot of money, either in efficiency, right, and productivity. And if you talk about productivity, it goes directly to GDP, or it's about feeding content and experiences to those users. And so that's what the, I think, late game of this new mobility as a service is really all about. So what comes next, right? I talked in the title that Lewis positioned is, what's next in mobility? Well, we think there's a total mobility revolt on the horizon. And it starts with the type of vehicles that we use day to day. So we talk about autonomous urban mobility, personal rapid transit, group rapid transit, cargo like Starship, and then services. So let me go through a couple of these, right? So we've seen some pods. Some of you have maybe even experienced the pilot that was here last year in Estonia, or the pilots that have been happening in the Nordics, in Denmark and Finland, and some other places. Then you get into what some of the big guys are doing, right? So this is VW Cedric, which is talking about becoming a pod taxi and more kind of an individualized taxi, not necessarily a shared taxi. So those are the things that even the big guys are thinking about, and their target is 2021, so 2-3 years from now. Then next mobility or next transportation in the UAE is talking about modular mobility and really individualizing and customizing that to the use cases. So in this case, a Starbucks on wheels or an office on wheels. I won't go into this because we just had a presentation about that. So Starship and some other logistics and delivery robots that are being deployed across the world. And then country right up the, I guess it's a little bit to the west and the north, Sweden, this company called Einride is looking at redefining large-scale transportation and logistics and creating completely autonomous logistics platforms. This clicker is really not working well. And then really in the future, there's people talking about modular mobility ecosystems. So having Rhine speeds, for example, having Snap-on tops on top of a skateboard, a Mobi Mart where groceries come to you instead of you going to the grocery mart, or even air taxis that can both be urban mobility vehicles on the ground and then convert into urban air mobility providers. And that's Airbus's concept, for example. So with that, what did you see there? Did anything really look like a traditional vehicle? No, they have all kinds of different sizes. They're not necessarily made for four people or five people. They may be made for one person or a small package or a large package. So the point is, the form factor of future mobility is changing. And why is it changing? It's changing because we have a lot more expectations about our mobility experience, right? We want our time to be ours. We want safety. We want to be conscious of shared resources and so on and so forth. So this is where Local Motors comes in and LM Industries. We are a digital OEM. We call ourselves the world's first digital vehicle manufacturer. And it creates products in a completely new way, and we use digital technology to increase our agility and efficiency at every stage of development, design, development, production, and service. And what makes up LM Industries? One of the things that's fundamentally different about us is we can go from concept to production ready in under a year. How many of you are still waiting on your Model 3 from Tesla that was supposed to be available last year, right? Even that, which was supposed to be fast, took almost 4 years from concept to production ready. And the reason why we do that is because we join a global community of designers and makers with direct digital manufacturing, and we produce in microfactories. Microfactories aren't big factories with millions of square feet and billions of dollars of investment, but they are 50,000 square feet to 100,000 square feet on 10 acres with maybe $25 to $50 million of investment in facility and tooling. But then we don't make 100,000 of something. We make 1,000 to 2,000 units that are highly flexible and highly modular because we use 3D printing additive, large-scale additive, and subtractive manufacturing to enable that. And we haven't just come up with that in the last couple of years. We've been doing this for the last 10 years. We've been building our co-creation community since 2008. It now members 200,000 people around the globe in 150 countries. We have currently two microfactories in the US plus a sales and demonstration facility in Washington, DC area. We have a number of patents and trade secrets around direct digital manufacturing, including the tooling, the software, the materials development, and the entire process that enables this. And then we have open labs partnerships with over 100 partners from all over the world, including Europe, Asia, Africa, Middle East, and of course, North America. So why does the world need a digital OEM? We need a digital OEM because consumers want and demand more customization, more choice, and more freedom in their mobility and transportation solutions. And we also need it because businesses need to have a far more wider-reaching impact to create better, higher-paying jobs, use fewer resources to make the planet and our solutions more sustainable. And then, obviously, we're a business, so we want to lower costs to increase profits so that we can continue to innovate and create faster, better solutions for our customers and the consumer. And this is our first solution, our first truly commercialized solution. It's called Ali by Local Motors. It's a self-driving, 3D-printed, electric, multi-passenger shuttle that accommodates 8 to 12 people, and it is mainly operated in a first and last mile scenario. This is our story. We started in Berlin in 2015. The first prototype that was functional was launched in Washington, D.C. in National Harbor in 2016. We did a pilot in the early stages in Berlin for about 7 to 8 months. And through that, we actually learned that our autonomy system wasn't quite right what we needed for the early applications. So we scoured the earth and we actually improved our robotics and autonomy system and relaunched the vehicle in April of this year at our demo days, where we hosted around 300 customers and investors over 3 days to give close to 150 rides in a very interesting and mixed-use environment. And obviously, if you're interested, that video is on YouTube and you can Google it. And then we actually announced at ITS World Congress in Copenhagen in September the launch of the Ali Fleet Challenges. So what are Ali Fleet Challenges? Ali Fleet Challenges are similar to what some of you may have heard about as Amazon HQ2 that just concluded after a year-long journey to put the Amazon headquarters 2 in Crystal City, Virginia, and Long Island City, New York. And what we basically said to organizations, cities, municipalities, local agencies, operators, if you go and give us great use cases and submit those to us, we'll get some judges together, we'll use our community to judge those entries, and then we'll provide Ali fleets for up to 3 months for us to together experience and test level 4, level 5 autonomy. And so that's what we're actually doing right now. Here's our roadmap. The first one we launched in Phoenix, California, where we do our production manufacturing for the pilot vehicles, and Sacramento, California, which is the capital of California. Most people may not realize that. It's not San Francisco or LA. It's actually a sleepy town just up the road from San Francisco. And we're launching the next fleet challenge in international location that we have not yet announced, and Washington, D.C. And then we continue on for another three challenges over 6 locations to bring autonomy use cases to local communities to experience level 4 and level 5 autonomy and learn together. So as I said, new mobility is the market. We believe as a digital OEM, we can serve the top 100 cities in the world using microfactories and co-creation. And we are leading the way, not just to redefine the experience of transportation using autonomy and some other technologies, but we're fundamentally redefining the ride. Because the form factor of the ride needs to be more flexible and more adaptable to our consumer needs going forward than it has been in the past. And by the way, that's not the only thing our technology enables. We've been doing other things besides transportation and mobility. We've actually worked with General Electric on appliances. We've done some things in furnitures. We've worked with Airbus on air mobility. And we're working with the US Marine Corps on military logistics, including Marines logistics. And then with HP, we've thought about populating Mars. So we're even thinking about space. So what does the future hold? The future holds a lot of opportunity for all of us to redefine and rethink what is a ride and how we use mobility. Thank you very much. That's my time.
Thank you, David.
No problem.
Very fascinated where we're going with this stuff. Now, we'll take a few questions from the audience. Do put your hand up. Our helpers will come around and give you a microphone.
I don't want to be.
Oh, it's too much responsibility. Yeah, exactly. We're going to leave it here. Okay, we got to deal with that. you kind of touched on a few other areas that you're talking about. I mean, right. Working with GE on appliances and furniture. Give us a quick insight. What are your visions for furniture?
We don't have necessarily divisions, we've been approached by a number of furniture companies about 3D printing furniture. Wow. So we, in my office, for example, we've outfitted several aspects of our office with 3D printed furniture. And the funny thing is it used to be like you could have any piece of furniture as long as it was black, right? Sure. Because just like Henry Ford, you know, black was kind of the base color.
That was, yep.
Yeah. So, but now we can print in multicolor, so we can make white furniture, blue furniture, green furniture, yellow furniture. So it's a lot of opportunity to use this technology to think about custom-made, purpose-built furniture.
Oh, wow, opens up a lot. Like, so many more things than anyone else would imagine. Do we have some questions from the audience here for David before we move on?
Oh.
Someone's cool ringtone, that's great, yeah. That's all right.
No question.
Oh. All right, here we go, yeah. Here we have a microphone. Thank you, sir.
David, are you going to franchise the factories and build them outside your facilities?
Yeah,
and
we can have
what will it take?
So great question. So we have an approach that we can work with our partners in different places around the world to actually go and jointly develop those capabilities and bring advanced manufacturing to Estonia or other places around the world. So we have a model. Generally, the way we enter it, it's either through our Ali Fleet Challenge and deploying a solution in the locality, or working over a multi-year engagement to redefine what mobility solutions may be using our Launch Fourth platform, which is what we're doing currently with the U.S. Marine Corps. So both of those paths are possible. It takes a little bit of capital, but it's not the kind of capital that a BMW or Mercedes plant may require.
That's pretty interesting, because our last speaker was also talking about with the Starship technologies, it's just huge amounts are needed to usually be able to do this, right? Maybe a little bit more than, I mean, hardware is always expensive,
right?
Probably more than software.
Yeah, so that's the thing is, right, it's hard to make hard things, right? And it is capital intensive, but capital intensity is different when you're talking about making 100,000 of something and a large factory on 1 million, 2 million square feet, where you're talking a paint shop costs you just, a paint shop alone costs you $750 million, or a stamping press alone costs you $500 million.
To do those huge volumes.
To do those huge volumes versus our factory, you don't get those huge volumes, but you get a lot more flexibility to build purpose-built vehicles for a local community, a local municipality, a local campus like Tallinn University or so on and so forth. And you're only investing, you know, $25 to $50 million.
Sure.
Yeah.
No worries.
You know. Any other questions?
Okay. All right.
Fantastic.
Anyone else there around there? You see the Estonians, they're so talkative. You'll never shut them up, mate. Like, they just go on and on forever.
Yeah, right. It's all good.
It's all good.
I'll be here all day.
You'll be here all week. Try the chicken. Yeah. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, one more round of applause for David Woessner.
Appreciate it. Thank you, sir.